Okay, I'm going to try to fit all of this in a 15-minute video, but what we're doing here first in this video is bone broth. So I like to do my bone broth in the instant pot. You can do it in a crock pot, you could do it on the stove, you can do it in a roaster, whatever you like to do. I personally do mine in an instant pot. I do wait until I have two chicken carcasses to use. And so if I have a carcass, but I'm still waiting for my second one, whenever we get through another one, I will put it in a bag, put it in the freezer, and then when I have two carcasses, I will put it one evening, put both of them in the Instant Pot. I usually start it about between 7 and 8 o'clock in the evening because I like to let it cook overnight and then deal with it in the morning. So I will put the two carcasses, its bones, skin, seasonings, whatever it was that I used to cook that chicken, is going in the Instant Pot. I cover it with filtered water to the max fill line, and then I put a splash of apple cider vinegar in it. So the apple cider vinegar helps draw all of those nutrients and everything that you want from the bones out of them into your broth. So you hear people say, okay, if you're sick, let's have some soup or make sure you drink all the broth in your soup. Well, that is very, very true when you're making a soup with bone broth. Soups that you get out of a can in the grocery store are not giving you the benefits that people are talking about when they suggest having soup or broth when you're sick. The soups from the store will realistically not do anything for you. But when you make a soup or any kind of meal that has bone broth incorporated in it, it is very, very healing. The gelatin that you get in the broth after you've made it and it's chilled, it's kind of nice and jelly. That's when you know, when it gets jelly like that, that's when you know that you have what you need for a good bone broth. If it is not jelly, it's not that it's not a good broth, but it's not quite as nutrient dense for an actual bone broth. So you do want that jelly consistency, and you do want to have a true bone broth to help your body heal. So cold and flu season is a really good time to keep bone broth on hand and try to get that some kind of way in your diet every week because we are very vitamin D deficient in the colder months. We are either not going out as much, or when we do go out, we are wearing a lot more clothing. And so we don't have as much as our skin exposed to have enough surface area on our bodies to absorb the vitamin D from the sun. So that's why cold and flu season tend to happen in the colder months because our vitamin D levels are a lot lower, which opens up our body to catching a lot more viruses and things. So, also, if you have somebody broken a bone, had some kind of surgery, even had a baby, giving them a meal or having them eat something that has a good bone broth in it is a good way to help speed their recovery and help support their body to heal a lot quicker and just boost their health in general. So while their body is recovering and fighting whatever it is that they went through, it's not getting worn down and susceptible to catching something else. So bone broth is very beneficial. When I make it, I get that apple cider vinegar splash in the water. I just put my lid on, put it on seal. I do set it on my max setting, which on mine it goes by hours. I did have one that went by minutes, but this one goes by hours. And so it's 4 hours on this one. I don't know if all of them are the same, but I set it for 4 hours. It builds up to pressure, it cooks overnight, and of course we're still sleeping after 4 hours, but it will slowly release its pressure, and then it will also keep it warm and just hold it the rest of the night until I'm able to deal with it in the morning. And so it is still nice and warm the next morning. It is still safe. And I just ladle it in these glass jars. I use 1/2 gallon jars because usually when I'm using it, I am going to use this whole jar. And I will fill it up until it curves right there at the very top. You have like the mouth, the little lip there by the mouth, and then you have like that curve right there, right underneath it, and that's where I will fill it to, and I will freeze it. As long as you don't go past that curve at the top where it starts to go up to the mouth, you will be able to freeze safely and it's not going to break because that's enough headspace for the liquid to expand. So after I finish dealing with my broth, and I do keep the lid off so it can cool off because it's still very hot. So I want it to cool off before I put the lid on and then stick it in the freezer. So it is still sitting on my counter cooling. But I am going to start dealing with the vinegars that I have had sitting on my counter for 6 weeks or better. So I did make apple cider vinegar and a pear vinegar. And so what I did here, I'm dealing with the SCOBY. I'm taking the vinegar SCOBY off the top of the apples. I'm peeling the fruit that is stuck in it off, and I'm placing it in a clean jar because what I'm going to be doing here is separating the apples from the liquid. And I'm doing that because with the fruit in there fermenting for the 4 to 6 weeks or better, this is, I think, longer than 6 weeks, but it's at least 6 weeks. It turns into a hard cider. So it's fermented to its alcohol form. To get it to ferment to its vinegar form, I need to separate that fruit from the liquid, put the liquid with the SCOBY, and cover it with something breathable again, and then after about 4 months, it will turn to its vinegar form. So if you want to try to make your own apple cider vinegar at home, you can use whole apples or apple scraps like I did. I used the peels and the cores from apple projects that we had done. But you do want to make sure you have either organic or farm fresh, because the apples that you get at the store, really even organic apples now, they have coatings on them. You used to be able to wash a lot of that coating off, but now they're coating them with things that cannot be washed off. And I'm not going to go into that real deep, but you do not want that in your body, and you definitely don't want it in your vinegar, when apple cider vinegar can be very healing. It can be a medicine of its own. Even the father of medicine used it to heal his patients. So you don't want any kind of contaminant to go into this vinegar. So you do want to make sure it's at least organic, if not farm fresh. Then you want to use 1 cup of cane sugar per gallon. So if you're doing half gallon, that would be 1/2 cup. 1 gallon would be 1 full cup. You do want to make sure it says cane sugar on it, and organic if possible, definitely unbleached. If it says just sugar and doesn't specify cane sugar, you want to stay away from that because that will be GMO beet sugar, and it's definitely not good for you. And again, you definitely don't want that to be in your vinegar. So we want to stay away from that. We want to make sure it says cane sugar. Then you're gonna do filtered water. So what I do, I fill my apples 3/4 of the way up the jar, and then I will have another jar that I fill with filtered water. I put 1 cup of the cane sugar. I will fill the jar only halfway because I want to make sure that I am getting all of that sugar when I transfer it over onto my apples. So I'll fill another jar halfway with filtered water, and then I will mix the cane sugar in it, get it nice and dissolved really well. And then I'll pour that on top of my apples. If I still don't have enough water after doing that, then just top it off with some filtered water. But at least you know that you got that sugar dissolved really well into your liquid. So then that sits covered on your counter for 4 to 6 weeks. You want it covered with something breathable because it does need to breathe to ferment. And you also want to make sure that the fruit flies don't get in there because they will want to. So you will let that sit on your counter for 4 to 6 weeks. The first 2 weeks, your apples will be floating. So you do either want to stir that around and get it nice and mixed up once a day for 2 weeks, or you can get something weighted, whether it's a glass bowl, a glass jar, or something that has a weight to it. Let it sit on top of those apples to get them underneath that liquid, and then cover all of that with something breathable for 2 weeks. And that will keep any kind of mold or mildew from building on top of your apples. So after the 4 to 6 weeks, or 6 weeks or a little better, it's okay if you go a little longer. We're going to strain the apples separate from the liquid, which is our alcohol liquid here, so our hard cider. And I'm pouring it into a clean jar with the SCOBY that had grown on top of it. The SCOBY is a good thing. The SCOBY is a symbiotic culture of bacteria and yeast, so also the mother of the vinegar. So the SCOBY is a good thing. Don't be afraid to see that. That means everything is going right. Okay, SCOBY is great. And so I'm pouring the liquid that we separate from the fruit into the jar with the SCOBY. And now we're going to make it go from an alcohol ferment to a vinegar ferment. And we're going to cover this with something breathable again to keep the fruit flies out. But we need it to breathe so it can ferment into that vinegar. And it's going to sit on the counter again for 4 months. So 4 months is going to give it a nice, good, higher acidity. You can go just 2 months if you want to, but that is a lower acidity. If you go 4 months or a little better, you get a higher acidity, which is more at the acid range of if you were to buy it at the store. So it is really simple. Most of it is hands off and you're just waiting. You know, it's fermenting on your counter and you're just waiting. So it is very, very easy. I have a pear one that I still have to strain, and some people even do it with pineapple scraps. You can do it that way too. And these are good bases if you want to make your own salad dressings, or, you know, if you cook with it somehow, or even, you know, put it in my bone broth if I want to, or even if you're feeling really bad one day, you just want to take a shot of that in a glass of water. It's actually really good for your body and supports your body and helps it heal as well. So now I am pouring some boiling water over my jars because we're going to be filling those with apples and canning up an apple pie filling. I have 40 pounds of apples that I have bought from Azure Standard, and I'm trying to get one of those 20-pound boxes taken care of on this day. And so I do end up doing about, I think it's 7-quart jars is what I ended up doing on this day. And that's all I did of the apple pie filling. The rest of it we just peeled, chopped, and froze them to use for other things. So for the 7-quart jars, in this pot I did 9.5 cups of filtered water, and then 4 cups of cane sugar, of course organic and unbleached. And then I did 1 cup of cornstarch, because that's what I had on hand. You can also use arrowroot powder, or I think another thing people use is called, I think it's called clear gel. It's another form of cornstarch, but I don't know. I just feel kind of weird about using it. I don't know a whole lot about it, so I'd rather stick with something that's a little more natural. So I use cornstarch if I don't have arrowroot powder, which I'm out of. Then 1/4 cup of lemon juice, 1 teaspoon of salt, 3 teaspoons of cinnamon, pretty sure I did a little more than that, 1 teaspoon of nutmeg, which I'm pretty sure I did a little more of that too. And so I just warm it on low on the stove, and I mix it until it starts getting thicker. So the camera got really blurry with this, and I couldn't get it to straighten up, so this is going to be a little blurry right here. But while that's warming up and getting thick on the stove, we're going ahead and chopping the apples. I do not peel them. I just chopped them real thin, and we're putting the apple pieces in the jar, and then the apple cores are going to go in the bowl that we had put the apple vinegar scraps in. The scraps, when you strain your vinegar, when you strain your vinegar and you have the fruit scraps that you had used, those are very, very good to, if you have chickens, give to your chickens. They're full of probiotics and they love them. It's very healthy for them. So anyways, we filled those jars with the apples, and now I'm ladling that creamy filling on top of them before I can them. And I'm going to be water bath canning them. And then Bryant had come home early this day because we had a meeting at karate. And so since he was able to be around a good bit before dinner, he took care of the rest of the apples for me that were in this box. And he peeled them and sliced them and put them on this tray with parchment paper. We stuck them in the freezer and kind of flash froze them before we put them in a bag. And we like to take those out of the freezer and we'll throw them in smoothies or use them in some homemade apple Pop-Tarts. Or, you know, if we need more for more apple pie because we don't have enough, or even in oatmeal.